And we pray for peace and for blessings on all his noble messengers, including the last of them all, the blessed Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we greet you on this, the first day of the month of Jumadi al-Ula, because the moon was not seen night before last. So today was the last day of the month of Rabi Uthani, the lunar month. And tonight the new month begins. So we greet you with Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, a greeting of peace on my behalf and on behalf of my distinguished brother Ken O'Keefe. And we begin by recognizing the owners of this hall and the manager of the hall, Javed, who was so kind, very kind, in consideration of the fact that we're dealing with Gaza, we're dealing with Israel, we're dealing with the Holy Land tonight, that they did not charge us any rent for the hall tonight, and we pray that Allah might bless them for this gesture. We did ask you to pay a small registration fee, and that was to block those who want to sabotage your program by registering and not coming. Now, then, our topic, listen carefully, is an Islamic eschatological explanation of Israel's master plan. There is a macro part of the subject which I will deal with from the Quran, but there is a micro part that my brother Ken will deal with because he is more familiar with what's happening on the ground than I do. And when I will take 40 minutes for my presentation, and I hope it will be adequate for me, and Ken will take 40 minutes for his presentation, and he should have more than that. And then after that, we'll have a question and answer session for a brief period of maybe half an hour, but it can be extended. So now then, Israel's master plan. And if we do not turn to absolute truth for an explanation, we might end up being confused and in a state of dismay. An absolute truth is in the Quran. Allah says so, that in this book there is al-haqq al-yaqeen, absolute truth. And so let's turn to the Quran at the beginning of our talk. And when we do so, I want to begin with something with which most of you are familiar, but others are not. And this is a narration in the Quran of an event which occurred when a very arrogant ruler who was stamping his feet with arrogance on a people who worshipped the one God, who was oppressing them, and who was about to seek to deliver what Netanyahu would describe as the final blow. And then Allah asked his servant to take a staff and strike the water. And because of a miraculous quality inside of that staff, known as the minsa, the water parted. And the servants of Allah, the believers, were able to cross the Red Sea in safety. And when that arrogant ruler, with his bloodthirsty army, attempted to cross the sea, the waters came down. Prior to this, he was declaring, I am the Lord Most High, Ana Rabbukumul A'la. I'm hearing the same thing today in Gaza. Ana Rabbukumul A'la. I am the Lord Most High. Even the United States must listen to me. And then when he was drowning, Pharaoh realized he was not God. And then he said, underneath the water, no one knew about, no one knows what happened underneath the water, not even CNN and Al Jazeera. He said, I now believe in the God of the Israelite people. And then Allah Most High responded, and these are his words. Ba'da'udhu billahi min ash-shaytanir rajim. When you're quoting from the Quran for the first time, you must always say, A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytanir rajim, seeking protection from Satan with Allah. Allah, now Pharaoh, now you make this declaration, وَقَدْ عَصَيْتَ قَبْلُ, and before this you were in arrogant and obstinate rejection, وَكُنْتَ مِنَ الْمُفْسِدِينَ, and you were spelling monstrous corruption and destruction on earth. Now Pharaoh, فَلْيَوْمْ, today, Pharaoh, I have decided. فَالْيَوْمَ نُنَجِّيكَ بِبَدَنِكَ. Today, I have determined that I am going to protect, preserve your physical body. Why? لِتَكُونَ لِمَنْ خَلْفَكَ آيَةً. That your physical body, when it is rediscovered, when it resurfaces in history, will function as a sign for a people to come after you. وَإِنَّ كَثِيرًا مِنَ النَّاسِ عَنْ آيَاتِنَا لَغَافِلُونَ. Well, most people are too busy to bother about my signs. This is Surah to Yunus of the Quran. And so I ask myself, that your body might function as a sign for a people to come after. What is that sign? What is that sign? The body of Pharaoh was discovered and positively identified. It was discovered in 1897, about the same time that the Zionist movement was established in Basel, in Switzerland. What could be the sign? Allah sent the Quran to people who think. But there are those who say no. Knowledge is a package. And that package is already sealed. And all that we need to do is to transfer that package from one generation to another, and all that you need is to memorize this kitab and that kitab and that kitab. But Allah said, I sent the Quran to people who think. And He says in the Quran, Inna sharra dawwab, Inna Allah, the worst people with Allah's sight, Summul bukmul ladhina la yaqilun, are the deaf and the dumb who do not think. So we are in good company when we reject that bogus scholarship that says that knowledge is a box that is sealed. You don't have to think. And when we think and we offer a view, only Allah can confirm that we are interpreting correctly. So there is no need for any boxing gloves. So what could it be? لِتَكُونَ لِمَنْ خَلْفَكَ آيَةً, that when your body is discovered, it would function as a sign for a people to come after you. And my answer, and Allah knows best, is that when the body of Pharaoh is discovered, history will repeat itself. That a people who will live the way Pharaoh lived, with arrogance, a people who will stamp their bloody feet upon a defenseless people who worship the one God, and slaughter them, treat them like cockroaches, that people who will follow the way of Pharaoh will die the way Pharaoh died. The last moment when they're moving for the kill, and now the state of Israel will be rid of all its enemies, and Israel will be triumphant, and our version of truth will end with history. At that last moment, the same thing will happen, which happened with Pharaoh, and they will be destroyed. And if this interpretation of the Quran is correct, then we still have plenty of tears to shed. We still have much pain to suffer in the months and years ahead of us, before that time comes when history will repeat itself and the Holy Land will be rid of this bogus state of Israel and true to time. That's my first reference to the Quran on the subject of the Master Plan. And Father, for the Jews and for the Christians and for the Muslims, all three of us, we all recognize Abraham as our father. And he goes to his son, but the Quran chooses not to identify the son. And there is wisdom in this, that Allah did not identify the name of the son. And he says to his son, Inni ara fil manami anni azbahu, that I have seen myself sacrificing you, a human sacrifice, human sacrifice. And he says to his son, Maza tara, how do you respond? The son understood it to be literal. And he says, Ya abati fa'al ma tu'mar, oh my father, go ahead and do what you've been ordered to do. And when Abraham put his son's head on the block to sacrifice his son. Then Allah Most High called out to him and said, "You have already fulfilled my vision, my command. My command never required you to engage in human sacrifice. My command never required you to engage in human sacrifice. No, I wanted you to accept the sacrifice of the seed of this son. I wanted you to accept the sacrifice of the seed of this son." Which son is it? Ibrahim alayhi salam accepted it. And so while we weep, we shed tears, our hearts are weeping today, we have to remember that Allah asked him to accept it, and he accepted it, the sacrifice of the seed of this son. Which son is it? Someone changed the Torah. These are heavy words I use. And I don't use these words recklessly at all. Someone changed the Torah and wrote into the Torah that the son of the sacrifice was Isaac. But today we are not living through something else. Our Prophet said, the best of those who came from Ishmael alayhi salam, are the Kinana. And the best of those who came from the Kinana are the Quraysh, the tribe to which the Prophet belonged. And the best of the Quraysh are Banu Hashim, the clan to which the Prophet belonged. And the best of Banu Hashim is me. I am the best. And so our Prophet declared that the Arabs came from Ishmael. And the Israelite people, of course, believe that they have come from Isaac. And what we now witness is that the seed of Isaac, since the body of Pharaoh was discovered, the seed of Isaac has been oppressing the seed of Ishmael and demonizing them. The worst person on the face of the earth today, the most despised, is an Arab. And now they're moving in for the kill, and that's the genocide in Gaza. And we therefore say that what we are living through in Gaza at this time is the fulfillment of this vision of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And it was the son of Ishmael who was to be sacrificed. We turn now to a third reference in the Quran. The Quran speaks about the Israelite people in a chapter or a surah entitled the Israelite people, Banu Israel. And in this chapter or surah at the very beginning, Allah says that this was written, this was ordained work. وَقَلَيْنَا إِلَى بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ فِي الْكِتَابِ لَتُفْسِدُنَّ فِي الْأَرْضِ مَرَّتَيْنِ. That Banu Israel will commit fasad. Fasad is something terrible. It is that which corrupts to the extent that it can destroy like cashless money, virtual money, paper money. Fasad is a criminal act for which Allah has ordained the worst punishment of all. Banish them. And if that is not enough, then cut off their hands and feet on opposite side and crucify them. This is in the Quran. But the two periods of fasad of the Israelite people took place before the Quran was sent down. The first time after the death of Solomon, Nabi Sulaiman alayhi salam. I think Ken is probably familiar with some of the Arabic terms by now. After the death of Solomon, Nabi Sulaiman alayhi salam, and they can engage in fasad, they corrupted the Torah. The Torah had prohibited money being lent on interest, and borrowed on interest. And they rewrote the Torah to say that an Israelite is prohibited from lending money on interest to another Israelite. But he's permitted. He can lend money on interest to the rest of the world. Meaning, don't rip off your own brother, but you can rip off the rest because they're just like cockroaches. I know that my language is very, very strong tonight. And this is going to provoke a storm when this lecture gets on the internet. I know that. But the hour has arrived for the truth to be proclaimed, regardless of consequences. And so when they corrupted the Torah, Allah banished them from the Holy Land, because this was fasad. And they were taken to Babylon in slavery. So that was the first fasad. And then Allah allowed them to return to the Holy Land. But there's a Roman government in charge. And again they engage in fasad, one of which got Jesus, Nabi Isa alayhi salam, so angry with them that he turned over their tables and he chased them out of the temple or the masjid, and he said, "You have taken the house of God and transformed it into a den of thieves, like Lower Manhattan." And then again Allah expelled them from the Holy Land. And then, of course, this was after the attempt of crucifixion. So the two periods of fasad have already taken place before the Quran was revealed. But how come we are now living through a third fasad, worse than the first and the second? Why does the Quran say two when there are three? That's the question. I battled with this question for most of my scholarly life. But sometimes the truth is right in front of you, but you don't see it until Allah opens your eyes. And that's what happened to me. The reason why the Quran said twice, when in fact we're now living through the third, is that this time it is not Banu Israel who are in charge. The decision makers of the genocide in Gaza are not Banu Israel. Then who are they? The same people who control power in the modern Western world are the same people who control power in Israel today. And they don't have any genetic link at all with the Israelite people. Indeed, the Arabs have much closer genetic ties with the Israelite people than these European people who rule over Israel today. I think the ruler of Israel today, Netanyahu, came from Poland. So who are these European people who rule over Israel who are not Israel? Israelite. Yes, they say they are Jewish, but they are not Israelite. The Quran tells us about Al-Masih al-Dajjal, and that's not our subject tonight. But the Quran tells us that when Allah destroyed the town and expelled the people from the town and placed a ban on them that they could never return to this town to reclaim it as their own, until Gog and Magog are released, and then they spread out all over the world, and with their indestructible power, they take control of power in the world for one time. Only once in history will this happen. Let me repeat that this will happen only once in history. That the people who never walked on the stage of the world would suddenly take power, take control of power in the world, and they would be a ruthless, arrogant people who have PhDs in oppression and deception. They got a PhD in deception. And these people will spread out all over the world, including India. Ask Gandhi. Ask Nehru. Ask Jinnah. They will tell you. They will spread out all over the world. And then they will bring these people back to that town to reclaim it as their own. And the Quran does not identify the town. You have to think. And that's what I do. And they are angry with me because I think. And they shut the doors of the masjid on me because I think. And I say that the town is Jerusalem. And my argument is that our Prophet himself identified Jerusalem to be linked with Gog and Magog. Because our Prophet said that Allah will destroy Gog and Magog in Jerusalem. So who brought the Israelite people back to Jerusalem? Answer: it's modern Western civilization. That's right. And therefore, those who control power in modern Western civilization are Gog and Magog. You may differ with me, no problem. But wait on Judgment Day and see who is correct. Wait. And those who control power in Israel today are Gog and Magog. If the Islamic resistance in Gaza knew this subject, then they would have responded differently. But they don't know this subject. And it appears to me they're not willing to learn. And so now we are able to understand that you do not have the power to be able to destroy Israel. No, because it's Gog and Magog. Iran cannot do it. Well, then what do you do when you're facing Gog and Magog? Answer, in Surah Al-Kahf. It is a policy of resistance to the oppression of Gog and Magog by building barriers between you and them, because Zulkarnain built a barrier. And because it is Karnain, and one Karn already occurred, there's another one coming. But that's another subject. So do not despair, because Allah is going to destroy Gog and Magog one day. And it's going to be biological warfare. They wage biological warfare with us with COVID. And the expression is, what comes around, goes around. So you attacked us with biological warfare, and in the end, the Lord God will destroy you with biological warfare. So yes, the tears will fall, but don't let hope and faith leave the heart. I want to turn briefly to Dajjal, the false messiah. And you are familiar with the subject by now. You've read Jerusalem in the Quran that was written some 20-something years ago. And you know that Allah created him. And Allah programmed him to use computer language. And he is programmed to impersonate the true Messiah. The true Messiah, when he returns, he came and he left and he will return, will rule the world from Jerusalem, from a holy state of Israel. And he will have his ummah with him. And this is what Allah says in the Quran. So others who have a different view, don't listen to them, listen to Allah in the Quran. Allah says about a people who follow the Messiah, Jesus, he says, I'm going to raise them, the followers of Jesus. I don't follow Jesus. No. I follow Muhammad, Allah, blessing be upon them both. But those who follow Jesus, I pray in the direction of the Kaaba. I know there are others who pray in the direction of Washington, but I pray in the direction of the Kaaba. And they pray in the direction of Jerusalem. So we are two different people. I fast in Ramadan, and my fast begins at dawn and ends at sunset, because night commences at sunset. But they have a different law of fasting. They fast from sunset to sunset. I am not allowed, at least in this life, to drink wine. But they can drink wine, they're not prohibited. So we are two different communities. And Allah says that I'm going to raise those who follow Jesus to a position of dominance over those who have rejected him. And who are those who have rejected him? Today, I'm using the word for the first time. They're called Jews or Yahud. That's the definition in the Quran. And today the Jews are in alliance with Zionist Christians. And they are the ones who have given to the world the North Atlantic treaty organization, NATO in French, L'OTAN. And that is this one of the superpowers in the world, led by the United States of America, in what is known as Pax Americana. So Allah is going to raise a people who follow Jesus to a position of dominance over NATO, over NATO. And when Allah raised this Christian people to that position of dominance, the Quran is saying that they will remain in that position of dominance until the end of the world. They can teach something else in political science in their universities, but this is absolute truth. So this is the Messiah who is to come. So if a false Messiah is to impersonate him, that false Messiah must also become the ruling state in the world. And that's why the British army liberated Jerusalem, and then Britain allowed the baby to be born, the state of Israel. And the Western world remained so obsessively attached to Israel, feeding the baby, protecting the baby, arming the baby, until the baby grows into an adult. And the baby is now so strong that an Israeli prime minister could say, we control the United States of America. Anybody else says that, the Marines will land in your country, but not Israel. And so now we are moving to a stage of history that I have to turn one more time to the Quran to explain before I end. I'll have more to say later on, but this is the building the foundation for tonight, the master plan. In Surah Al-Mursalat of the Quran, Allah speaks of a shadow. What is the definition of a shadow? A shadow is something which is connected with a person or a thing. It is connected with a person or a thing. You can have a shadow of a stick, and you can have the shadow of a person. And Allah says, in Taliko, proceed. Let history now proceed. In Taliko ila zillin zi salasi shura. Proceed to a shadow comprised of three parts. This is ayah mutashabiha. You have to interpret it. Whose shadow it is that is comprised of three parts? And Allah has sent this way people who rejected His sign, rejected the Messiah. And we say the shadow is the shadow of Dajjal, and Allah knows best. And therefore, that the Antichrist has a trademark. His footprints come in three parts. And we said it 20-something years ago, that in the first part of the shadow, the world experienced that horror called Pax Britannica. And in the second part of the shadow, the world experienced a greater horror called Pax Americana. Ken is very familiar with that. And now the third part of the shadow is appearing, and it is Pax Judaica. That Israel must flex its muscles. Israel cannot be the ruling state in the world when there are those who are hostile to Israel, living in the midst of Israel and around Israel. And so what explains the conduct of the Israeli government and the Israeli armed forces since last November is they're now attempting to clean up the area within Israel and around Israel. If you want to live in this land, you got to bow down and submit to us and live as our slave. Otherwise, we're going to destroy you and throw you in the desert and drop bombs on you until you learn to submit to us and be our slaves. As we were once the slaves of Pharaoh, you must now be our slaves.